buildings. They have been our homes, offices, shops, shelters, and eating places throughout human history. Some, like the pyramids of old, have stood proud for thousands of years. Skyscrapers are beginning to reach hundreds of meters high. So strong and so heavy, they need explosives to bring them down. But why? What material is so strong, so tough, so resilient, needs such a great force to break it down? Welcome to Crazy Concrete in Construction. Concrete has made a huge impact on our lives. This small city in 1750 has become the London skyline, and concrete made the big change. It all started with mud huts in Egypt, which were the first concrete-like structures utilizing sand, water, and stone that was then baked in the sun and built brick after brick. The Chinese endeavored with the first huge construction when building their Great Wall of China, which used cement to hold the stones together and create a stronger structure. The Romans also used cement to build their civilization across Europe, with buildings that had to be made of using local materials such as sand, stone, and water, which are the building blocks of concrete. Between Roman times and the Middle Ages, cement was mostly forgotten until Joseph Aspidin of England invented Portland cement by burning finely ground chalk with finely divided clay in a lime kiln until carbon dioxide was driven off. The sintered product was then ground, and he called it Portland cement, named after the high-quality building stones quarried at Portland, England. One of the first, largest, and oldest structures using modern concrete is the Hoover Dam in the USA. There was enough concrete in the dam to pave a two-lane motorway from San Francisco to New York. So that's the history of concrete, but how is it actually made? Here is a factory that produces precast concrete made off-site. Concrete is made from cement, usually Portland cement. It then uses aggregates like sand to make different types of concrete for different circumstances. For example, a concrete bridge or a concrete tower. They each need concrete that is suited to that individual task. Here, the aggregate for the specific task is sand, and it is being mixed with water. Gravel is another aggregate, and in this case is being used to create a texture and colour for the concrete as well as a look. Here the sand and water are being mixed with gravel and cement in a large mix. These are the raw materials of concrete and are essential in its creation. Sand and gravel are very common aggregates, but increasingly recycled aggregates are being used instead of natural aggregates. Concrete is weak in tension, can also be reinforced using fibres of steel rebar so that the reinforcement can hold the tensile loads instead of the cement. Adding fibres of different aggregates like stone can create specialised concrete that is useful in different circumstances. Additives further diversify different types of concrete, and they are used to give concrete certain characteristics not obtainable from a plain mix. Examples are accelerants, which speed up the hardening process, and pigments that change the colour of the concrete for aesthetic purposes. Concrete is then poured into a mould that gives it shape. It is then allowed to harden. Accelerants will speed up this process and retardants will slow it down. Concrete then hardens into a shell like this. Different aggregates and pigments will change the look, texture, and colour of the concrete. This is how precast concrete is made, which is concrete made off-site and then shipped to a building site. Concrete can also be poured on-site using a cement mixer and aggregates. This is usually done for concrete whose look, texture, and colour don't matter. So we have seen how concrete is made, but why is concrete used in the building industry? Here is a piece of concrete. It is a young modulus of 30 gigapascals, which is relatively high compared to other non-metals, but low when compared to metals like steel, which is a young modulus of between 190 and 210 gigapascals. Concrete has a relatively high compressive strength of 30 megapascals, which makes it incredibly useful for making tall structures. It is similar to common house bricks, which have compressive strength between 20 to 40 megapascals. Concrete has a very low tensile strength of only 3 megapascals, which is also similar to household brick. This is why concrete in buildings has concrete pillars to support it, as the pillars will take most of the weight and remain standing due to their high compressive strength. However, if there are no supports, the structure falls down and breaks. So what is actually happening within the concrete? Back with our previous diagram, when the large weight is added, stress is applied to the concrete. The concrete is in tension at its lower half, and in compression in its upper half. If we flip the concrete over on this diagram, where the large weight is being applied, there is compression, and below this compression, there is stretching of the material, which causes tension. Let's look a little deeper. Here is our concrete block again, magnified, and here are the tension lines. Look, a crack. Because concrete has a low tensile strength, cracks can appear easily, because the force is greater than the low tensile strength. As well as this, the crack can propagate easily through the material because there is a small area which causes a huge stress, as can be seen in the equation stress equals force divided by area. As the area increases, the stress decreases. Let's look even deeper. We are now at the molecular stage and the concrete has been magnified hundreds of times. White molecules are feeling the full force of the stress, and because the area is only a molecule in length, the stress is amplified greatly. This bond won't last very long. And look, there it goes! Now the next bond is feeling the full force of the stress. This crack will now propagate through the structure as each bond gets broken. Each of these breakages will happen many times a second. So how come metals don't break so easily but concrete does? Here is our piece of concrete with a crack that's propagated quite far through the material. Now stress lines have been added to the diagram to show that the crack deflects tensile stress and the stress is concentrated below the crack. This means that the crack continues to propagate down the concrete. Here is a similar sized piece of metal that has a similarly sized crack in it. Tension is applied to it. This time, the stress lines are less deflected and the crack has been reduced. Metals resist cracking because they are ductile, and under stress, cracks are broadened and blunted, and they do not propagate. Unlike metals, concrete is not ductile, and so the crack is not reduced. So in concrete, why is it so easy for cracks to propagate through the material? Here is an image of concrete magnified many times. Concrete is not a smooth surface, and has many whole pieces called grains, and many holes in between called dislocations. To demonstrate this more clearly, here is a bubble raft, which is created using glycerol fat and natural gas. The red line shows the boundary between two grains. In between them and where the line is, are many holes or dislocations. In this picture, the dislocations can be seen more clearly, and are represented by the red dots. These dislocations are separate from each other, creating an area of no grain structure. Bubbles, instead of being grouped in six around one bubble, are disorganized and weaken the structure. Here is a picture of random dislocations and separate grain structure put together. This is a blown up picture of three random dislocations that are causing bubbles on either side to become disorganized. So what does this have anything to do with concrete? Well, cracks follow the areas where two grains meet. If there are lots of grains, it will be easier for a crack to propagate, like in concrete. However, if there are fewer grains, cracks find it harder to propagate, like in metals. Concrete is a composite material, and so the different sizes of molecules in the different materials that make concrete, i.e. cement, water, and aggregates, like sand and gravel, all create dislocations. Without the ductility of metals, the dislocations make the concrete brittle and easier to break apart, like brick. Concrete has been an important building material for a long time, and will probably still be long into the future. New aggregates, additives and mixes are being developed all the time as our egos and structures get larger and larger. Every concrete mix is different, each being used for a different purpose, and you will probably pass a concrete building at least 10 times a day. And here, to finish off and demonstrate the immense strength of concrete, is a fighter jet smashing into a concrete wall.
Time for a new test using an F-4 Phantom jet. The US government wanted to test what would happen if a plane crashed into the concrete walls of a nuclear power station. The jet sets off, bolted to a track to prevent takeoff. It's doing 500 miles an hour. The plane atomized with the impact. It just disappeared into dust. Only the tips of the wings escaped total destruction.
Thank you for listening, and are there any questions?